This video is all about creating a Python program that converts any video to GIF format. You can change any video to GIF by using this Python program. This is a very simple Python project like other Python projects we done in the previous time. So the main task for this video is to create or to write a Python code that helps you to convert the video to GIF format. First, I wanted to clearly describe this Python coding project. First, you need to understand what is GIF format means, because in this video, we need to write a program to change the video to GIF. Okay, when we see a video, video files have different formats like .mp4, .mov, .wmv, and many more. Those are some common file formats. For this project, I use .mp4 video file format. And change this video file format to GIF file format. Okay, now we will see what are GIF file formats. GIF stands for Graphics Interchange Format. GIF is a raster file format designed for relatively basic images that appear mainly on the internet. GIF files also allow images or frames to be combined and creating basic animation. So this Python project is all about writing a program code that converts video file format, which is .mp4 format, to GIF format or graphical interchange format. These GIF image files are commonly used on the web to display graphics and logos. They also support basic animations, which means they are a popular file format for memes or social media sites. Okay, if you understand this, the next point is start coding this Python project by opening any Python IDE. For this project, I use PyCharm Python IDE. You can also use your own favorite Python IDE. Okay, now I open PyCharm. As you see, I am on the PyCharm homepage and I create a new Python file to start coding. Okay, now before we start coding, we need a video file to convert to GIF file format. If you don't have a short video, you can search for any video on the internet and download it and put it in the same folder to this PyCharm Python file to execute without any error. I already have a video, so I will put this video and my PyCharm Python file by opening a new folder. So now I will create a new folder and I give the folder name video to GIF, like this, and inside this folder I put my video. Okay, now we can start coding on PyCharm. Firstly, I will import important Python modules for converting this video to GIF. So I write from moviepy.editor import star, from moviepy.editor import star, like this. This star is used to import everything from moviepy.editor class. By the way, moviepy is a Python module for video editing, which can be used for basic operations like cuts, concatenation, title insertion, video composition, video processing, or to create advanced effects. It can read and write the most common video formats, including GIF. So you need to import this Python module. However, if you are the first time when you use this Python module, you need to install it to your Python project first before importing it. So to install, you can use PyCharm itself. At the bottom of PyCharm, you can click this terminal and it opens like this. After that, you can write pip install moviepy, like this. Pip install moviepy. When you hit enter, it starts to download and install it. However, for me, I already installed it, and now the only thing is importing this Python module and use it. For that, for importing, you can write from moviepy.editor import star. So this is the first step of this Python project. Okay, now we move to the next coding, which is creating variable and store a video file. For that, I write video like this equals video file, clip. And inside this parenthesis, I will put my video file name. For you, you can write your video file name inside a single or double quote. This single or double quote is used to pass the video file name as a string. And when you write this video file clip, V, F, and C are capital. And this video file clip is one of a function in the MoviePy Python module. So you can write video equals video file clip like this. And for me, I write my video file name, which is my underscore video dot mp4. This is my video I put inside that folder because my video file format is mp4. So I write my video name, my underscore video dot mp4, inside a double quote like this. Okay, after that I write video dot write underscore gif, and inside this parenthesis I give the file name to save the gif file. So I write my underscore video dot gif inside the single or double quote. You can use one of them. So I write like this, my video dot gif inside a double quote like this. Okay, now we finish this Python project, so we need to run this Python code and see how it converts the video to GIF file format. So now I click and run it. And as you see, it starts to convert it. It shows the percent, how much percent it is converted. It may take some time depending on the video language and your computer processing speed. And after it finishes the process, you can go to the folder, you put your video file, and you'll get another additional file, which is .gif file format. For me, you can see this file. This file format is, as you see, .gif file format, like this. So in this Python project, we write a program that converts video to .gif file format. Okay, this is all about this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks again. Text-to-speech Python project. In this Python project, we will write a Python program that converts any text to speech. As you know, previously we'll see different types of Python projects like that. This Python project is also a very simple and easy Python project. The main aim of this Python project is to change any text to speech. You can write any text or you can copy and paste any text, and this Python program converts it to speech. And to create this Python program, we will see in a detailed explanation for each line of code. This video is all about creating Python programs that converts text to speech. Now we can start this Python project. Like other Python automation projects, for this project I use also a PyCharm Python IDE. I also recommend you to use a PyCharm Python IDE for this Python project. By the way, if you don't have a PyCharm IDE, you can use any other Python IDEs you want to use. That is your option. For this Python project, my recommendation is using PyCharm Python IDE. Okay, now I open PyCharm to start this project. I already have a PyCharm Python IDE, so I open it now. As you see, now I am inside this PyCharm homepage, so I create a new file in PyCharm. For that, I click New at the top and click Python File. And after that, you can give the file name. For this project, I give the name text to speech. And when I hit enter, it opens a new blank Python file. As you see, this is a blank document, and now I start coding in this section. Okay, let's start now. As we said before, in this Python project, we create a Python program which converts text to speech. So to start this Python project, I want to import important Python modules, which helps us to facilitate this process. If you search text to speech Python modules, you will get different types of Python modules like PyTTSX3, GTTS, or Google text to speech, or you can get any different Python modules. For this project, I use this PyTTSX3 Python module because it works offline. But for example, if you use GTTS or Google text to speech, it doesn't work offline. It requires an internet connection. So I use PyTTSX3 for converting text to speech. Okay, now you need to import this Python module to your Python code. For that, I write import PyTTSX3 like this. However, if you are new to PyTTSX3, you need to install this Python module before importing to your project. So you can use PyCharm to install this Python module. For that, you can click Terminal at the bottom of this PyCharm, as you see, and it opens like this. If you click Terminal, it opens like this. And to install PyTTSX3, you write pip install PyTTSX3. And you hit enter, it starts to download and install automatically. For me, I already installed this Python module, so I don't install it again now. So I only import it to use for this project. After you install, you can import by writing import PyTTSX3. So this PyTTSX3 is a text-to-speech conversion Python library. Unlike alternative Python libraries like GTTS, it works offline. This PyTTSX3 works offline, and this PyTTSX3 is compatible with both Python 2 and Python 3. Okay, after that, we create an object for this Python module. After you install, the next point is creating an object. For that, I write engine equals PyTTSX3.init. I create an object called engine. So engine equals PyTTSX3.init. Okay, after we create an object, we need to see the voice option for our computer. The next point is that means you need to know how many voice options and select one of them from the list of your voices. So now I want to write a program to see my computer voice option, and after that I select one of them to convert text to speech, one voice from the list of the voices. For that, I use for loop to do this. So I write for voice in engine dot get property, voice in engine dot get property, and inside this I write voices inside a single or a double quote, and after that I put a colon at the end, and inside this for loop I write print voice. Okay, now I run this program and it shows all voice options. So you see this program shows the list of the voices. For me, it shows two voices, as you see. For example, the first voice is name equals. It shows name equals Microsoft Zara Desktop English United States. And the second voice option is name equals Microsoft David Desktop English United States. So I have only two voices. For that, I want to select one of them. So the next is writing a program that gives voice option. For that, I create a variable called voices, and voices equals engine dot get property, voices equals engine dot get property, and I will pass a voices inside this parenthesis. After that, I write engine dot set property, engine dot set property, and inside this parenthesis I will pass voice inside a double or single quote, and I wanted to index the voice ID for that, for those voices, and I put the square bracket for indexing, and for this I give 1 inside this square bracket, and after that I write dot ID like this. You can also change 1 to 0. You can index 1 or you can to index 0. Because I only have two voices, for that I have two indexes only, 0 index and 1 index. For this project, I give index 1. Okay, this program gives the option for our voices. Later we finish this code, we can see the voice by changing this index 1 to index 0. For now, I will give or I will put index 1 as you see, like this. Okay, now after we finish this program, the next is creating a function that helps us to convert text to speech. I call it text to speech function. For that, I create a function called speak. You can give any name for your function name. For this project, I call it speak. And inside this function, I use engine object I create in the above section, because this engine object helps us to create a program that converts text to speech. So now I write div speak, and inside this parenthesis I pass audio. As we know, to create a function in Python programming language, we use the div keyword, and after that we write a function name. Like that, I write div speak audio, and at the end I put a colon for indentation. Okay, now inside this speak function I write engine dot say, and inside this parenthesis I pass audio. This engine dot say function is used to speak our program. So we use this class from the PyTTSX Python module. After that I write again engine dot run and wait. This engine dot run and wait function is also inside the PyTTSX Python module and used to wait our program for the next execution. For that we use this function. Now we finish the creation of our program function, which helps us to convert text to speech. The next step is writing a program that asks the user to enter the text to convert it to speech. Okay, now I create a new variable called text, and I want to ask the user to enter any text they want to convert to speech. So I write text equals input, and inside this parenthesis I write enter your text now, like this. This input function is a Python built-in function that is used for asking the user to input any prompt. For that I use this input function, and this text equals input, and inside this parenthesis enter your text now. This program uses to accept the user a text, to enter a text. After that, or at the end, you need to call a function we create above to execute our program. We need to call this Python function we create above to execute our program. As we know, whenever we create a function in Python, we need to call them to use the function. For that, we create a function called speak, and now we need to call it. For that I write speak, and inside this parenthesis I pass text. This text is a variable that stores the user text. So I call this function like this, speak, and inside this parenthesis I pass text. Okay, now we finish this program. The next is running this Python program and see how this program works. Okay, now I will input any text and see how this Python program works. You can also copy and paste any text you need to convert to speech. Okay, let us see different options like changing the voice index and also putting different texts to this program.
My name is Awoke from LearnToCode. In this YouTube channel, I will upload so many programming videos related to different Python projects, about data science, machine learning, deep learning, computer vision, and also, you will get blockchain tutorials. So, if you want to get those contents from me, please subscribe to my channel and turn on the bell icon to get a notification when I upload a new video.
Okay, this is all about this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks again. In this video, we'll see how to create a digital clock by using Python programming language. This is a very simple Python project like other previous projects we see in the channel. At the end of this Python project, you can create a very simple and attractive digital clock by writing sublime of codes in Python. Okay, for more understanding, now I will show you what this digital clock looks like. For that, I run this Python code, and as you see, this is a digital clock and it shows the current time and it updates every second. So today's video task is creating these types of digital clock by using Python programming language. Okay, now we can start coding to create your own digital clock. Okay, when we come to this video, this is a very simple Python project which helps you to create a very simple digital clock. Now we can start coding this project. For that, I use PyCharm Python IDE. You can also use this Python IDE, or you can use your own favorite Python IDE. For me, PyCharm is the best Python IDE for these types of Python automation projects. For that, I open PyCharm and create a new Python file. As you see, this is a blank Python file which is ready to write a Python code. After that, we need to import important Python modules. For this project, we need user interface module and also the time module for displaying the current time. For that, first I import tkinter Python module. This tkinter Python module helps us to create a pop-up display window for showing our digital clock. Tkinter is one of the Python user interface modules, so I wanted to use this tkinter Python module for this project. So I write from tkinter import star. This star is used to import everything from this tkinter module. So from tkinter module, I import everything. Okay, now we import this Python module. The next important Python module we need to create this digital clock is time module. This time module is used to display your computer time in this program. So we need to import this Python module. For that, I write from time import strf time. This strf time is a function in the time module, and it is used to display the operating system time. Okay, we finished importing important Python modules. The next important point is creating a pop-up window to display time by using tkinter window. For that, I create an object by writing tk class from the tkinter module. So I write root equals tk like this. Root equals tk. This program creates a tkinter window to display a time. After that, we need to give the title for our window. For that, I write root dot title. Root is an object. So root dot title. And inside this parenthesis, you can give your title name. For this program, I give the title digital clock. You can give any name you want to give. For this, I write like this root dot title, and I give the name digital clock. This code helps us to give the title for our project. Okay, after that, we need to style and label our window. For that, I write label equals label, and inside this parenthesis I pass root font, background color, and foreground color. You can give any font type, font size, and also you can give any color for the background color and foreground color. So for this Python project, I give the font equals Arial inside double quotes, and I will give size of 160 the font size, and I give also bold. After that, I will put comma, and I will give the background color. For that, I write BG means a background color equals, and I want to give the background color black. For that, I write black like this. After that, I will put comma and give the foreground color. So for the foreground color, I write FG equals, and FG means a foreground color. So I write white. I wanted to give white for the foreground color like this. Okay, this is the label for the digital clock, and at the end I wanted to pack this label. For that, I write dot pack like this, and inside this pack parenthesis I write anchor equals center comma f fill equals both and expand equals 1. After you put dot, you can write pack and inside the parenthesis anchor equals center, fill equals both and expand equals 1, like this. Or you can write label dot pack, and inside this pack parenthesis you can write like this, label dot pack and anchor equals center, fill equals both and expand equals 1 by separating a comma from one another. By the way, this packing method integer packs widgets to rows and columns for labeling positions, so you can use this packing method. Okay, now we finish the styling and labeling of our window. After that, we move to the next step, which is creating a function to display time on the label. So, as we know, to create a function in Python, we use a div keyword. For that, I write div type. This time is a function name. You can give any name you want to give for the function name you want to give. For this function name, I give the time for simplicity. After that, inside this time function, I create a variable string. String equals strf time, like this. String equals strf time. And inside this parenthesis, I write hour, minute, and second. And at the end, I put p for displaying am and pm. This strf time is a function inside the time Python module. So using this function, we can display time on the hour label. So after that, I write label.config. And inside this, I write text equals string. Label.config and text equals string, like this. Label.config, and inside that parenthesis, you can write text equals string. String is a variable we created before. So this config function helps us to display the string variables on the label window. Okay, next I write label.after, and inside this 1000 comma time, 1000 comma time, like this. Label.after, inside the parenthesis 1000 comma time. This program helps us to update every 1000 microseconds, that means every seconds. Okay, now we finish our program. The next is calling this function and run it. As we know, to call any function in Python, we need to write a function name. So to call this function, I write this function name. For that, I write time, like this. And at the end, I write root.mainloop. Root.mainloop. This root.mainloop is used for opening and controlling our tkinter window. So this root.main for loop is also important. Okay, now I run this Python program and see what it looks like. As you see, this program works. It shows our computer time like this. You can also change the font or the label or the colors for styling this window. Okay, this is all about today's video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks again. In this video, we will see how to generate a barcode by using Python programming language. In this Python project, you can generate so many barcodes by running only one Python code. As you know, barcodes have so many uses in modern world, like identification cards for products, or you can use barcodes for different staff identification. So in this Python project, we can generate different barcodes by using Python. This is a very simple Python project like other Python projects we see. So let's get started. Okay, when we come to this Python project, I use PyCharm Python IDE. For this Python project, I also recommend you to use PyCharm IDE. However, if you wanted to use other Python IDEs, you can use your own favorite Python IDE. Okay, now I am in PyCharm IDE, and this is my working page. I already created a new Python file to start this project. So To start this Python project, first we need to import some important Python modules which helps us to generate barcodes. Okay, the first important Python module we use to create barcode for this Python project is Python barcode. This Python barcode is not built in Python modules like turtle, datetime, tkinter and many more other Python modules. So we need to install this Python module to use for our project. Okay, now the first step from this Python project is installing this important Python module. So as you see, I use a PyCharm Python IDE and I use this IDE to install Python barcode. Okay, to install any Python module from Python from PyCharm, you can use two ways. The first one is using terminal section at the bottom of the PyCharm IDE. You can click this terminal and it opens your Python file path to install Python module. As you see, when I click this terminal section, it opens like this, and after that you can write pip install python slash barcode like this. Pip install python slash barcode, and you hit enter, it starts installing it to your Python project. I already installed it before, so I don't install now, but if you don't install this Python barcode before, you can install it in this way. Okay, after that we need to import this Python module to use for our project. For that I write from barcode import ENA 13 ENARA capital. This ENA 13 means European Article Number 13, and it is one of Python barcode standards, so you need to import this. There are so many Python barcode standards you can use for your project. However, for this project, I wanted to use this ENA 13 Python barcode standard. If you wanted to use other Python barcode standards, you can see available barcode standards and use one of them you want to use. But for this project, I select this European Article Number 13 Python barcode standard, so I import this. Okay, next I also import from barcode dot writer import image writer like this. From barcode dot writer class, I also import this image writer class. So this image writer is used to generate our barcode as PNG format. As we know, barcode is an image, so if you don't import image writer from barcode, the final barcode outcome becomes as SVG format. Image can be PNG or SVG, or it may be JPG format, but the default barcode image standard from this Python project is SVG format. For that, to get the barcode in the PNG format, we need to use this Python module. For that, to get the barcode in the PNG format, we need this Python module. So we need to import image writer to convert SVG format to PNG format of the image. Okay, after we import this Python module, the next point is write a program which asks the user how much barcodes they want to generate. This Python project is not only to generate one or two Python barcodes. You can generate many Python barcodes as you want. If you need one barcode, you can generate one barcode only. If you need 10 barcodes, you can generate 10 barcodes. If you need to generate 100 or 1000 barcodes, you can generate by using this Python code by running only one. So we need to a program to ask the user how many barcodes they need to generate. So I write num underscore of underscore barcodes. That means the number of barcodes. You can give any variable name. This is my variable name. I say that num underscore of underscore barcodes equals, and I use input Python function to ask the prompt from the users, and I use also int function to convert string to integer, what we call it typecasting in Python. So num underscore of barcodes equals int input, and inside this parenthesis I write a question how many barcodes you need like this. ask this question, how many barcodes you need, and I convert it to integer format. So num underscore of barcodes equals input, and inside this parenthesis I write a question, how many barcodes you need, like this, how many barcodes you need, and I convert it to integer format. For that I put int function at the start of this code, like this. Whenever you use input function to accept any prompt, it saves in string format. For that we need to change string to integer. For that I put this int function at the beginning. Okay, after that I create a variable number, the variable name number, and number equals range, and in this parenthesis I pass the number of barcodes, the variable I create before. This number of barcodes are a variable we create at the above, and it has a value of the numbers of the barcodes the user wants to generate. So number equals range, and inside this parenthesis I'll put num of barcodes, like this. This range function is used to generate a sequence of numbers for generating barcodes. For example, if you want to generate 10 barcodes, it generates a sequence of numbers starting from 0 to 9 at the total of 10 sequences. Okay, if you ask me why you need to generate a sequence of numbers from this program, the answer is I wanted to use for loop to generate many barcodes in one program. For these types of programs, using for loop is the best option. For that, I use for loop. Okay, for that, I write a program for I in range, and I pass the numbers. So for I in range in numbers, after that I put a colon at the end. This colon is used for indentation in Python program. Okay, after that I create another variable inside this for loop, and I call it id. This program is used to ask the id of a product or a unique identification of each barcode. For example, if you wanted to generate 10 different barcodes, you need to enter 10 unique ID for each barcodes. For that I write a program ID equals input, and inside this parenthesis I ask the user to input the ID of the barcode. So inside this parenthesis I write give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. Give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. Inside a double quote, or you can use a single quote, because both single and a double quote in Python is easier to write strings. So you can use one of them, and you write give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. Okay, now after we ask the user to enter ID for each barcode, the next point is creating object from this ENA class, or European Article Number 13 class. As we say before, ENA 13 means European Article Number 13, and it is one of a Python barcode standard. So now we create an object from this class. For that I give the object name my underscore code, and this my underscore code equals ENA 13, or European Article Number 13, and inside this parenthesis I pass ID and writer. So this code is my code equals with ENA 13, and inside parenthesis I write ID comma writer equals image writer, like this. This code is used to generate a barcode. So the next is saving this barcode. To save all barcodes we generate, we need different file names. That means if you generate 10 barcodes, you need 10 file names to save each barcode. So to save them, we need to ask the user to enter the file name for each barcode. Okay, for that I write the program or the code to ask the user and save it. So I create a variable name equals input, and inside this parenthesis I write give the name to save barcode. Inside a single, or you can use a double quote, because it must be a string. Okay, after that my code dot save, and inside this parenthesis I pass name. This code is used to save the Python barcode with a given name. Okay, now we already finished this Python project, so The next point is run this code and see how this code looks like. Okay, to run this Python code, I will click and select run Python barcode file. And as you see, this program asks me how many barcodes you want to generate. So I write 4 because I want to generate 4 barcodes. You can give any number you want to generate. So I give 4. After that, it asks another question which says, give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. You need to give 12 digit numbers for your barcode ID. After that, it asks me, give the name to save a barcode. And you need to give the name to save. So I give the name barcode 1. Okay, as you see, after that, it asks me again, give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. So you need to give barcode ID for the second barcode. The first 12 digit number is for the first barcode. This is for the second barcode. So you need to give different ID. After that, it asks again, give the name to save this barcode. And I give the name to save it as barcode 2. Okay, it asks the barcode ID for the third barcode. So you need to give different ID for the third barcode. And after that, you need to give the name for saving the third barcode. For that, I give the name barcode 3. Okay, now it asks me, give 12 digit numbers to your barcode ID. This is for the barcode. And so I need to give a barcode ID. And after that, it asks me the name to save it. So I write barcode 4. Okay, after that, it says process finished with exit code 0. As you see, this program ends and it doesn't show anything from this. However, if you see the Python file from this section, it generates all barcodes. That means it generates a total of 4 barcodes with the name barcode 1, barcode 2, barcode 3, barcode 4. As you see, it generates, and you can see by clicking each of them. You can see by clicking barcode 1 and it shows the barcode 1. You can click barcode 2 and it shows barcode 2. You can click this barcode 3, it shows barcode 3. You can click this barcode 4 and it shows barcode 4. This is all barcodes we generate from this program. If you want to generate another barcode, you can run and generate another barcodes. Okay, this is all about how to generate a barcode by using Python programming language. This is all about this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks again. Python Turtle Project. In this video, we'll see how to use a Python Turtle module for creating a very simple and amazing Python animation. This is a very simple Python project like the previous Python project. We can create the best looking animation by writing some line of codes. Okay, before I start coding, I wanted to show you what types of animation we create after we write some line of codes in Python. Okay, I'll click and run this code. As you see, this is the first Python Turtle project we create. From this project, you can change any property you wanted to change, like the speed of the turtle, the color, or any other property, and you can draw so many types of animation by your own. Okay, now we come to the coding section. I use a PyCharm Python IDE for this Python project, and also I recommend you to use a PyCharm Python IDE. If you have a PyCharm Python IDE, you use PyCharm. If you don't have a PyCharm, you can use any IDE you want to use. Okay, the first step is creating a Python file. You can create a Python file with any name you want to use, and start coding by importing Python Turtle module. So for this Python project, I will give the name Python Turtle Project. Python Turtle Project, like this. I give this name and start coding. Okay, as you see, this is my working environment and I start to import Python turtle model. So I write import turtle like this. Import turtle. This turtle module is already built in Python module, so you don't need to install it. The only thing expected from you is importing it by using import keyword. Okay, after I import this Python module, I write turtle.bgColor. This bgColor is used to change the background color of our turtle. And inside this single or double quote, I will give to be black. I need to be black background color. If you need to another background color, you can change the color. So turtle.bgColor, and I will put black inside this double quote. Okay, after we give the background color, the next is giving the turtle drawing speed, the speed of the drawing. To do that, I write turtle.speed and I give to 0. I wanted to draw this faster animation. For that, I wanted to be the speed 0. You can give any number you want to, by the way. The main point you must understand is the greater the number, the slower the speed of your turtle animation. So for this project, turtle.speed, and I will give 0 for speed. Okay, after that I write turtle.hideTurtle. As the name indicates, this code helps us to hide the turtle. That means we need to see only the animation part, not the turtle itself. So turtle.hideTurtle, this code is also important for this project. Okay, after this I wanted to give the color of animation. For that I create a variable colors and I will list the colors. So colors equals, and inside a single or double quote I write yellow, green, blue and red. I want to give those colors for my animation. If you wanted to change any color, you can change by writing the color name here easily, and you can change it. For this Python project, I use those colors. Colors equals yellow, green, blue and red. I use only four colors by separating with a comma. Okay, after we select the colors for our animation, we come to the main part of this Python project, and I wanted to use a for loop for drawing those animations. As we know, for loop is used to repeat the same thing again and again until the iteration is done. So to draw those types of animation, I use for loop execution. So I write for I in range, and I will give a range stop number 500. After that, I will put the colon at the end. I think you know about how range function works in Python. This range 500 function generates screens of numbers starting from 0 up to 499. That means it generates a total of 500 screens numbers for iteration. So I write for I in range 500 like this. And after that, I use another for loop inside this for loop for iterating the colors of our turtle. I will create a variable which contains four colors. So I create another for loop inside this for loop for iterating those colors. For that, I write for C in colors, and I will put colon at the end for C in colors like this. After that, I write turtle.color, and I will give C for our turtle color, turtle.color C, and also turtle.forward, and I will put I inside this parenthesis. This code helps us to draw a forward with the I distance. So turtle.forward, and inside this parenthesis I will put I. Okay, the next is turtle.left with an angle of 91 degrees. So turtle.left, and I will put 91 degree. I will also write turtle.tracer, and I will give 10. This tracer function is to facilitate the drawing of our complex graphics. You can use or you can leave if you don't want to use. For this drawing, I use it. So turtle.tracer, and I will put 10. Okay, now we come to the finishing of this Python turtle project, and at the end I will write turtle.mainloop like this. Outside from this for loop, and this turtle.mainloop code helps us to open this turtle window. So I write like turtle.menloop. Okay, now we complete the coding part. The next is running this Python file and see how this turtle draws. For that, I click and run this Python turtle project. And as you see, this is our Python turtle project and it starts drawing these types of animation. If you wanted to change any property from this animation, you can change it very easily, like the colors, the speed, the angle, and also you can change the loop for iteration. Okay, this is how this Python turtle project looks like. This is all about this video. Thanks for watching. If you have any doubt about this Python project, feel free to put in the comment section. Thanks again. I'll see you in the next video. We will challenge ourselves to start coding on this coding challenge video. Okay, first we will see what this coding challenge looks like. This coding challenge is writing a Python program that asks a user to enter two numbers and return the sum of those numbers. First, this program asks you to enter the first number. After that, it asks you to enter the second number. And after that, it prints the sum of num1 and num2 is, and it gives the sum of the two numbers. Now, for more understanding of this coding challenge, we will show you how this program works. As you see, when I run this program, it says enter the first number. I give, for example, 2, and after that, it asks me again, enter second number, and for the second number, I will write 3, and hit enter, it gives this result. The sum of 2 and 3 equals to 5. Like this, you can run it again and give any number you want to sum, and this program returns the sum of those two numbers. I think you get some concept about this Python coding challenge. Now we can start coding this challenge with a detailed explanation for each line of code we write for this Python program. Now we can start this coding challenge. To start coding in Python, we need Python IDE. So for this coding exercise, I use a PyCharm Python IDE. If you have a PyCharm, you can use it. If you don't have a PyCharm IDE, you can use any Python IDE you want to use. Now, as you see, I already create a new Python file inside PyCharm, so I can start coding now. Okay, the first point is writing a code that asks the user to enter the first number. For that, in Python, if you need a user to enter any prompt to your program, you need to use input built-in Python function. So for this case, I also use the input function to ask the user to enter the first number. For that, I create a variable num underscore 1 and equals num underscore 1 equals input. And inside this input function I write enter the first number like this. You can use a single or double quote because both single and double quotes are used to write strings in Python program, so you can use one of them. Okay, I also added one important concept to this Python program. Whenever you use input function in Python, it stores the value in the form of a string, so you need to use typecasting to change a string to integers. When we enter numbers, numbers are integer data type. For that, we need to change string to int data type. For that, I write int at the beginning of this program, like this. And the final code to ask the user to enter the first number is num1, num underscore 1 equals int. And inside this int parenthesis, I write input. And inside this input parenthesis, I write enter the first number, like this. Okay, this code is used to ask the user to enter the first number. Like that, I also write the code which asks the user to enter the second number, because I wanted to write a program which asks the user to enter the first number and the second number and gives the sum of those numbers. So I will copy the first code and paste it from the second code. The only difference is the variable name and the string I write inside this input function. So the second code looks like this: num underscore 2 equals int input, and inside this parenthesis I write enter the second number, like this. This code asks the user to enter the second number and it stores in the variable name num underscore 2. Okay, now we finish the program which asks the user to enter two numbers. After this, we move to the next section. Okay, now we need to create a function that is used to calculate the sum of two numbers. For that, we need this function. As we know, to create function, we use the def keyword. After that, we give the function name and pass the two parameters. For that, I write def sum, and inside this parenthesis, I pass two parameters. Those are num1 and num2. And at the end, I will put a colon for indentation for this function. Okay, after that, I write inside this function return num1 plus num2, like this. This program returns the sum of two numbers. Okay, now we have already created a function, so the next point is calling a function to use it. Whenever we want to use a function, we need to call them. For that, I create a variable, and this variable calls this function and print the sum of those two numbers. For that, I write a program s equals sum, and inside this parenthesis I pass num1 comma num2, like this. And after that, I write print the sum of num1 and num2 equals s. Print the sum of num1 and num2 equals s, like this. And after that, you can run this Python file to see how this function works. Okay, now we finish this coding challenge. So the next is I run this code to see how it works. For that, I click this and click run this Python file. And as you see, this code runs and it asks me to enter the first number. And you can give any number you want to sum. For this, I give number 12. After that, it asks me to enter the second number. And for example, I write 3 for the second number. And at the end, it shows the sum of two numbers like this. Okay, this is all about this coding challenge. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks again.